In August of 1945, as the world celebrates the end of the Second World War, out in the Pacific, the Americans make a puzzling discovery. The U.S. Navy has intercepted a Japanese submarine, and it's unlike anything they've seen before. Its scale is baffling. But not only is it the world's largest submarine, it's an entirely new kind of weapon. A submarine that can launch torpedo dive bombers. The Americans have just stumbled across Japan's secret underwater aircraft carriers. And soon, they'll uncover a sinister plan that could have changed the course of the war. Japan's surprise attack on Pearl Harbor in December of 1941 is an event that galvanizes a nation, pulling a reluctant America into the Second World War.
The unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday.
A day after the devastating attack, the United States declares war on Japan, and the nation quickly mobilizes, firing up its enormous industrial might to crank out ships, tanks, and aircraft at a rate that'll soon bury Japan's military. For the Americans, Pearl Harbor was a senseless and cowardly provocation. But for the Japanese, the attack was something entirely different. A calculated gamble, and a long-shot attempt at actually trying to avoid a full-scale war with the United States. Because as the Empire of Japan continued its ruthless conquest in Asia, the Japanese were convinced that it was only a matter of time before the U.S. intervened. And the architect behind the Pearl Harbor attack, Japanese Admiral Yamamoto, was aiming to knock out much of the U.S. Pacific Fleet in one decisive blow, as a way to keep the United States out of the Pacific for at least another 6 months, and perhaps even forcing the Americans into negotiating a truce. But Imperial Japan grossly underestimated America's resolve, and in the aftermath, Yamamoto knew America's military might would soon overwhelm Japan's. Now faced with a war he cannot win, Yamamoto devises another strategy. To make America reconsider a drawn-out war in the Pacific, he'll bring the war directly to America's cities. But with the United States now on guard for Japanese forces, Yamamoto will need a truly stealthy weapon to reach the United States. A weapon the Americans would never suspect. The concept of launching aircraft from a submarine originated before the Second World War. But these earlier attempts were experimental trials, usually involving a single lightweight reconnaissance plane. What Yamamoto had in mind was far more ambitious, a fleet of submarines that could carry multiple attack aircraft and strike fear into the enemy by launching surprise attacks on cities, only to submerge and disappear again. In March of 1942, Japanese engineers were handed the enormous task of designing Yamamoto's secret weapon. To start, Yamamoto's aircraft-carrying subs would need to be capable of launching full-size torpedo dive bombers, and engineers would have to design a catapult launch system and a mechanism to recover the aircraft and bring them back on board. But making the bombers fit inside a submarine would be an even bigger challenge. With a typical World War II-era dive bomber having a wingspan of about 12 meters, engineers would also need to design an entirely new dive bomber, one that could be folded up to fit inside the sub's hangar. The submarines would also need to be able to reach any part of America's coastline, thousands of kilometers away, and then return all the way back to Japan without refueling or resupplying. And it meant carrying nearly 2 million liters of diesel fuel and enough supplies to support a crew out at sea for months. Japan's secret underwater aircraft carriers would be designated as the I-400, and they'd be enormous, nearly twice the length of a typical German U-boat. To support the weight of the hangar and to keep the sub stable during carrier operations, engineers innovated a double hull design, essentially two hulls stuck together. It gave the mammoth I-400 nearly three times the displacement of even the largest American submarine. And the I-400 was still a formidable submarine in the conventional sense, armed with 8 forward-mounted torpedo tubes and a massive deck gun. And to fend off enemy aircraft, 3 triple-mounted anti-aircraft guns and a 4th single-mounted gun on the sail. But of course, the I-400's primary weapons were its 3 torpedo dive bombers. The element of surprise was an underwater aircraft carrier's greatest advantage. And as the I-400 silently approached its target, its crew would already begin preparing the aircraft. Mechanics would start by running heated oil through the aircraft's engines, so they would be warmed up and ready to launch. The mammoth submarine would surface a few hundred kilometers from its target, and the race would be on to get 3 bombers airborne. Each aircraft would be rolled out from the hangar onto the deck. Crews would then start the engine, unfold the wings and tail, lock floats into place, and load armament. One by one, the 3 aircraft would be launched using a compressed air catapult. The whole process would take 30 minutes, after which the I-400 would dive back to safety and silently wait for the bombers to return from their mission. The torpedo dive bombers were cutting edge. They were designed specifically for the I-400 and could carry the largest bomb or torpedo in Japan's naval arsenal. Equipped with a pair of floats, the aircraft would land alongside the submarine to be hoisted back aboard using a collapsible hydraulic crane. The aircraft could also be launched without floats for greater range and performance, but forcing the pilots to ditch into the ocean after their mission. The I-400 was a brilliant design, merging the stealth of a submarine with the offensive strike capability of an aircraft carrier. But Japan's new superweapon would make no difference in the war. On August 15, 1945, after nearly 4 years of brutal conflict, and with American forces closing in and the bombing of Japanese cities, Japan finally surrendered. The Americans first intercepted an I-400 off the coast of Japan 2 weeks after the surrender. And at first, they weren't exactly sure what it was. The Japanese crews had thrown all of the attack aircraft overboard. And at first, the Americans believed that the I-400 was designed to carry cargo. But they'd soon unravel the submarine's true purpose, and why Japan never used them in the war. To start, many in Japan's Navy considered Yamamoto's underwater aircraft carriers to be a farce, and the slow process of launching aircraft in the middle of a combat zone too dangerous for submarine crews. But resistance to the concept would soon be the least of Yamamoto's concerns, because it took nearly a year to design such an unconventional weapon. Construction of the first I-400s only began at the start of 1943. By then, the Japanese were already losing the war. After a crushing defeat in June of 1942, the Americans were pushing the Japanese back across the Pacific, and Japan was running critically short on fuel and raw materials, delaying I-400 construction even further. And Yamamoto himself would never live to see any of his submarines completed. In 1943, while on an inspection tour through the South Pacific, Yamamoto's plane was downed by American forces. What started as a plan to build a fleet of 18 underwater aircraft carriers was eventually whittled down to just 5, and only 3 were ever completed, the first entering service in 1945, so late in the war that Japan's military had already all but collapsed. Launching sneak attacks on American cities with a handful of dive bombers would have been pointless. Even a more strategic mission to bomb the Panama Canal was abandoned after Japanese command felt that it too would have made little difference so late in the war. The only mission the I-400 would ever set out on was a last-ditch effort to bomb American forces as they amassed off a tiny Pacific atoll. But as the first I-400s traveled to their targets, Japan surrendered, finally ending the Second World War. aircraft carrier submarines had always been a gamble, a way to change odds so stacked against Japan that only through sheer ingenuity could the tables be turned. And had the sub arrived at the start of the war, it might have made a difference. But Japan's secret weapon wasn't without compromise. The process of launching three aircraft was supposed to take 30 minutes, but rarely could it be accomplished in less than 45. A dangerous amount of time for such a large submarine to be surfaced. And the I-400's bombers, while sophisticated in their design, were rushed into service and built from lower-grade materials due to shortages. They were notoriously unreliable. Rarely could all three get airborne without some mechanical problem. And the enormous I-400's depth time, critical for getting out of danger, was nearly double that of American submarines. Even submerged, it was still vulnerable. With a hull that was riveted, not welded, it likely would have stood up poorly against depth charges. Still, the Americans considered the I-400 to be a dangerous weapon, especially in the wrong hands. And in 1946, with the Soviets demanding to inspect the subs for themselves, the Americans scuttled the I-400s off the coast of Hawaii in Japan, keeping their exact wreckage locations secret, and closing the chapter on an ambitious new kind of weapon that, in a different set of circumstances, might have changed the course of the war. This video originally appeared on Nebula, a streaming site that I helped create. Nebula is where you can watch Mustard videos before they're on YouTube, without any annoying advertisements or sponsor messages. It's also home to a growing number of Nebula originals, like Real Engineering's ongoing series on the logistics of D-Day, long-form documentaries by Wendover Productions, and experimental content by your favorite creators. Right now, you can get Nebula for free when you sign up for CuriosityStream. With CuriosityStream, you get to enjoy thousands of high-quality documentaries by some of the best filmmakers in the world. From history to science to nature, CuriosityStream's ever-expanding catalog will let you take a deeper dive into fascinating topics. Get unlimited access to both CuriosityStream and support your favorite creators on Nebula, all for just $2.99 a month, by going to curiositystream.com/mustard and using the promo code MUSTARD when you sign up.